inside me. And you call me out to pull me in. You tell me I can start again. And I don't need to keep on hiding. I'm fully known and loved by you. You won't let go. No matter what I do. And it's not one or the other. It's hard truth and ridiculous grace to be known, fully known and loved by you. I'm fully known and loved by you. It's so like you to keep pursuing. It's so like me to go astray. But you guard my heart with your truth, the kind of love that's bulletproof. And I surrender to your kindness. Oh, I'm fully known and loved by you. You won't let go, no matter what I do. And it's not one or the other. It's hard truth and ridiculous grace to be known, fully known and loved by you. I'm fully known and loved by you. How real, how wide, how rich, how high is your heart? I cannot find the reasons why you'd give me so much. How real, how wide, how rich, how high is your heart? Now I cannot find the reasons why you'd give me so much. Truth and ridiculous grace to be known, fully known and loved by you. I'm fully known and loved by you. It's so unusual, it's frightening. I'm fully known and loved by you.
Good morning, Greencastle Presbyterian Church, and welcome to our worship service on this Sunday of June 21st. It is Father's Day, so happy Father's Day to you all. We're so glad that you have tuned in this morning, and the service is a very special service in many ways, and we have two liturgists helping us, Brooklyn Barnhart and her brother Luke, and we're grateful for them, and grateful that you're all watching, and grateful too that you're sharing the link to many, many others, and spreading our ministry very far. Thank you for all your patience during this time. The last 3 months have been really life-changing for everybody, and we know that we have more yet to go, but we're patient people, we're people of faith, and so we're grateful that God leads us and gives us the promise that he'll never leave us or forsake us. So enjoy this morning's service. Welcome.
Good morning to GPC, thank you for tuning in today, and thank you for how you've been holding together for the good of our church. As one of our younger members, I welcome to this service online, and I'm so glad that you let me share and serve in God as a liturgist today.
Thank you. morning, GPC.
Good morning, Greencastle. So, you know what today is, Liam?
Father's Day.
That's right, it is. It's Father's Day. Today's a good day to say thanks to all the dads and the grandpas and all the men who act like a dad in our lives, right? They help us learn each day, and they help us by taking us places and doing things for us. So it's definitely a good day to say thank you. And I have some things here that remind me of dads.
A screwdriver.
That's right, I do have a screwdriver. I have a screwdriver because that reminds me of all the things that dads fix. When things are broken around the house, they help fix them. And sometimes we want to build something new, maybe a new toy or something to play with, and a screwdriver can help us do that.
A baseball glove.
A baseball glove, that's right. That reminds me of baseball. You like to play baseball, don't you?
Yeah.
And who helps you do that?
Daddy.
That's right, Daddy. And Daddy takes you to practice, and he coaches you, and teaches you all about the game, right?
Mm-hmm.
Some more things here, too. Oh, I know you know what this is.
Money.
Money. This reminds me that Daddy goes to work every day, mm-hmm. right? What do we need money for?
So we can survive.
That's right.
Or live.
That's right. We need money to live. We need money to pay for our house and to buy food if we want to go on trips, maybe to the beach on a vacation.
Or if you want to rent a boat.
If you want to rent a boat. Want to go to Disney World, all those things cost money, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Daddy goes to work every day and earns money to help us have those nice things in our life. How about this one? What's this?
A Bible.
A Bible, that's right. So a Bible reminds me of Daddy because he helps teach us about the good news that we hear in the Bible, right? And he teaches us about Jesus and how we should go into the world and share that love. Train up a child in the way he should go. Even when he is old, he will not depart from it. Proverbs 22:6. So the Bible teaches us that God is a father as well. Even though we can't see him, he's real and he's always with us and teaching us too. He knows us and he's watching over us. And he loves us so much, just like your dad loves you and just like your grandpa loves you. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened and do not be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Joshua 1, verse 19. So no matter what, we have your dad and your grandpas, but we also have God the Father, who's always with us, always teaching us, always helping us. So I hope that today you can say thank you to Daddy and Grandpa for all the nice things they do for you. And also when we say our prayers, we should say thanks to God for all that he does. For always being with us, always teaching us, always guiding us, and always providing for us. Let's pray. God, thank you for all the men in our lives, dads, grandpas, and other men who help teach us, take care of us, and love us. And thank you for being a father and always watching over us. Amen.
Amen. Oh wait, I have a joke to tell.
Oh.
Three boys are in the schoolyard bragging about their fathers. The first boy says, "My dad scribbles a few words on a piece of paper. He calls it a poem. They give him $50. The second boy says, "That's nothing. My dad scribbles a few words on a piece of paper. He calls it a song. They give him $100. The third boy says, I got you both beat. My dad scribbles a few words on a piece of paper. He calls it a sermon. It takes 8 people to collect all the money."
That's a good one.
Please join me in the prayer of confession. Merciful God, forgive us, for we live as if the world revolves around our needs. Forgive us, for out of fear and scarcity, we waste all that you have entrusted to us and destroy the resources that can be used to nourish and uplift others. Forgive us, for we have become so mired in our luxuries and pleasures, we fail to recognize those around us who are without life's basic necessities. God of great compassion, turn us around. Show us again how to see beyond ourselves and break the idols of scarcity. Use your Holy Spirit to guide us in using our resources to benefit all in our community. Amen.
Fear not, for God forgives us and saves us from our selfishness and our fears, so that we can share God. Love purging for others. Because of God's love, we are delivered from the behaviors that we keep from us. Showing how Jesus lives in us and serves others through us. Thanks be to God.
People who are called by my name will humble themselves, if they will pray and return from their wicked ways, if they will seek my face, I will hear their voice from heaven. I will forgive their sins, I will hear their voice from heaven. I will forgive their sins. And I will heal their land. I will heal the land. I will heal. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, if they will pray and return from their wicked ways, if they will seek my face, I will hear their voice from heaven. I will forgive their sins, I will hear their voice from heaven. I will forgive their sins. And I will heal their land. I will heal their land. I will.
O God, we hold the Bible as your precious word to us, and let me start over. I think I went too silent. O God, we hold the Bible as your precious words to us, and you call us to hear your words. Guide us to get us back on the path, and let your love shine through us. Help us to hear and receive your words to us today. Amen.
Bend down, O Lord, and hear my prayer. Answer for me, for I need your help. Protect me, for I am devoted to you. Save me, for I serve you and trust you. You are my God. Be merciful to me, O Lord, for I am calling on you constantly. Give me happiness, O Lord, for I give myself to you. O Lord, you are so good, so ready to forgive, so full of unfailing love for all who ask your help. Listen closely to my prayer, O Lord. Hear my urgent cry. I will call to you whenever I'm in trouble, and you will answer me. No pagan God is like you, O Lord. None can do what you do. All the nations you have made will come and bow before you, Lord. They will praise your holy name, for you are great and perform wonderful deeds. You alone are God. Teach me your ways, O Lord, that I may live according to your truth. Grant me purity of heart so that I may honor you. With all my heart I will praise you, O Lord, my God. I will give you glory to your name forever. For your love to me is very great. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The main scripture lesson this morning is from Genesis chapter 21. This is the story of Hagar and Ishmael. The child Isaac grew and was weaned, and on the day that Isaac was weaned, Abraham held a great feast. But Sarah saw that Ishmael, the son whom Hagar the Egyptian had born to Abraham, was mocking her son. And she said to Abraham, "Get rid of that slave woman and her son, for that slave woman's son will never share in the inheritance of my son, Isaac." The matter distressed Abraham greatly, because it concerned his son. But God said, "Do not be so distressed about the boy and your maidservant. Listen to whatever Sarah tells you, because it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. I will make the son of your maidservant Hagar into a great nation, because also he is your offspring." Early the next morning, Abraham took some food and a skin of water and gave them to Hagar. He set them on her shoulders and then went off on her way, sent her off her way with the boy. She went on her way and wandered in the desert of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she put the boy under one of the bushes. Then she went off and sat down nearby, a few hundred yards away, for she thought, "I cannot watch the boy die." And she sat there nearby and she began to sob. God heard the boy crying, and the angel of the Lord called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What is the matter, Hagar? Do not be afraid. God has heard the boy crying as he lies there. Lift the boy up and take him by the hand, for I will make him into a great nation." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy as he grew up. He lived in the desert and became an archer. While he was living in the desert of Paran, his mother got a wife for him from Egypt. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. When writer Annie Dillard left her church and family in Pittsburgh to go off to college and become a writer, it was many years before she returned. But her career as a writer actually led her straight back to God. One Sunday morning, she opened the door of her childhood church, sat in what would have been a familiar pew to her, and she sat down. And nothing seemed to be changed. It was the same sanctuary, the same people, the same colors. Everything was the same. And then the liturgist stood to read the scripture. Now she was hearing scripture in that place where she had heard it so many times. But now she was awake to God and she was hearing. She observed around her that nobody seemed to be paying attention. And she wrote this: "It is madness to wear ladies' straw and velvet hats to church. We should be wearing crash helmets. Ushers should issue life preservers and signal flares. They should lash us to our pews, for the sleeping God may wake someday and take offense, or the waking God may draw us to where we can never return." Well, today is one of those stories that we read where we should have life preservers and crash helmets. The story of Abraham and Sarah presents us with raw drama and a lot of pain. Although God has chosen this couple out of all the couples to choose, they're really a hot mess. Abraham is a feckless character. Sarah is mercurial. She's got a temper and she's jealous. And yet, these are the people that God chose, which should give us some comfort. They're not much different from us. Hagar is in this story too. She's a slave. She knows about Sarah's temper. And to complicate matters, Sarah had given Hagar to Abraham to sleep with, and a child, Ishmael, resulted. It was to be Sarah's child, but she despised that boy of Hagar's and Abraham's. And then, maybe about 12 years or so later, she bears a son and calls him Isaac, which means God's laughter. When you have a baby at 90, you really need to laugh. Now fast forward some years until the boy is weaned. Think the time you put your kids on the school bus, about that age. Abraham hosts this wonderful party with many guests and rich food and lots of wine. He is so proud of his son Isaac. Sarah watches her son like a mama lion. And she sees Ishmael mocking his half-brother. And the anger within her boils up quickly. She's seething. And instantly she demands that Abraham kick that slave woman out and her nasty kid now. So what's with Abraham? Ishmael is his son. He has a responsibility to him and to Hagar. But he is, as I said, feckless, and he will not stand up to Sarah. He agonizes, but Sarah's counted to three and made up her mind. So what does he do? The next morning he gathers some food and some water. And he says, Egypt is that way. He points south. Time to go. It's been real. I did say he's feckless. Now south to Egypt, through the bottom of Israel, through Beersheba, is in the Negev desert. You can't take a bus through there. There's no bus. You can't thumb your way because no one's going through there. You have to walk. And there's nothing there. She couldn't even pick up a minimum wage job cleaning some horrible inn. It's just not there. What in the world was Abraham thinking? She has no compass. She has limited resources. She and Ishmael wander around, and the word wander means they have no direction. She's desolate, rejected, thrust out, hopeless. No one cares if she'll live or die. I think about the people who come across the Sonoran Desert in our Arizona. And how many die there and they find their parched out bodies. I wondered if she thought that would be her fate. So here she is, no food, no water, no hope. She takes her son, weakened by no food, parched because of no water, places him under a shrub with what little shade is available. They're going to die. She can't bear it. She goes a few hundred yards away. Her heart is beyond broken. She cannot bear his cries of, Mama, water, Mama, where are you? Mama, help me. She falls to the ground and weeps as one does when all is lost. And I wonder, as you hear this story, are you hearing the deep pathos within this story? This is why sometimes when we read scripture, you do need a crash helmet or a life preserver. But I wonder more importantly if you might identify with Hagar or Ishmael and their plight. I mean, can we dare to see ourselves as feckless as Abraham or as heartless as Sarah? If we could, it would take more maturity than perhaps we have, the kind of spiritual maturity to look deep within. You know, we're a people whose lives are shaped by the gospel. We believe that Jesus was sent into the world by God as the way, the truth, and the life. We believe that Jesus is the way to turn us from our own self-centeredness to deep compassion that heals us and heals the broken around us. We believe that we belong to a new kind of community where the love of God and the love of neighbor and even love and respect towards enemies is possible every day. We believe that God wants to change the world and that God uses our hands, our hearts, our bodies in that task. That Jesus unites us. He makes us one together. Through him, we promise to have each other's back, even through our differences, because we are one in Christ. We're a gospel community that looks out for one another, not just for we who are Christians, but for strangers, for those in the margins of society, regardless of race or sex or even creed, because we believe that God is our common Father. Jesus is our common brother, and the Holy Spirit unites us in the bonds of love in this new community. But sometimes we forget that, and we go back to that old chestnut of, I got mine. Sorry about yours. I find it strange that Sarah forgot her origins. She forgot that without God, she's got nothing. She is nothing. It was God who blessed her, and God who gave her the desires of her heart. It was God who gave her a hope, and she forgot that and looked upon Hagar and Ishmael really as just so much trash to be rid of. I can't even begin to explain Abraham and why in the world he wouldn't stand up to her, or how he could send Hagar and his own son Ishmael out to what seemed to be certain death. I mean, was he motivated by fear? It certainly wasn't faith. But God intervened. God heard Ishmael's cries. He heard Hagar's racking sobs. God points to her, a stream of living water flowing from a well right where she was, that God makes a way where there seems to be no way. You see, when God's people failed, God didn't fail. God looked upon her with love and mercy. God gave her a future and hope. There is that song, "There's a wideness in God's mercy like the wideness of the sea." It's a beautiful hymn. I wait for the day when we can all sing together in church again. But it tells us that God hears the cry of the abandoned, the cries of the outcast and the forgotten, and that God saves. God hears the cries of mothers whom our system fails. God hears the cries of those who have been so beat up in this world that it seems no one even cares. But we are that kind of community who are asked to care. This text speaks to us this morning. It is a story of failure, actually, the failure of God's beloved people to be the kind of people God calls us to be. And that's how it speaks to us in our tumultuous times. This is clearly a time of testing, and everything from here on out will be different. It will change one way or another. You can count on that. We may not like it, but it is reality. Everything around us that's swirling right now, the tension, the pain, the hate, the division, the politics, this is all a part of a test. I'm not saying that God has arranged all of this to play with us, but we've walked into it, and it tests what we're made of. And will we rise to our calling in Christ, or fall to our fears and our doubts? Let's not forget our origins, that apart from God, we are nothing, we have nothing. Let us rise to follow Jesus as he seeks the forgotten, who tends the homeless, the hungry, and the outcast. This is what I believe. If this nation will be a better nation, then we have to do what no politician or commentator or demonstration can do, that we have to be Christ in our community. That's God's call to us. And we begin by hearing the cries of the Hagars and Ishmaels, who are a part of our family. You know, Ishmael's name means God hears. God does. And Jesus calls us to hear. Let's not turn away. Amen.
Do you remember a song that had words, "Those were the days, my friend. I thought they'd never end." Well, that seems to express how I am feeling and how I have been feeling. The only thing I know for true is the Lord is my rock. First we had a pandemic, and now we have unrest and uneasiness all around us. So I'd like to share with you a new middle of the night poem that seems to express how I am feeling, and perhaps how you are feeling also at this point in time. The title of it is Awakening. I went to sleep and the world changed. I closed my eyes and love turned to hatred. Hope became despair and kindness turned its back. Clouds are blocking the sun and I can't see the light, even though my eyes are now open. Noise and chaos are overshadowing God's voice as I am struggling to hear. My hands are folded in prayer, and yet the words will not come to my lips. The sound of my voice cannot be heard, But I am calling on the Lord's name to guide my thoughts and ways for a better tomorrow, where forgiveness and understanding can awaken the joy of living in each new day.
I invite you to this time of prayer, and I ask that you would certainly be in prayer for our nation, but not ours alone, because we have brothers and sisters all over the world we have not yet met, and God calls us to be one people. And one day, in God's time, we shall all be one, red and yellow, black and white, precious in his sight. I do think of the needs here. We're grateful that Jean has come home and is healing up at home, and continue to pray for her. Continue to pray for Roger, and grateful for how God sustains him each day. Jan McLean has told us about a little girl named Molly who needs our prayers, who's really suffering. And I'm sure that there's many upon your hearts as well. So let us join together in prayer, and then join with me wherever you are when we pray the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, we give you thanks for this day, this Father's Day. Some are so blessed to be with their dads. Many dads are blessed to be with their families. Some are separated because of this virus and because of distance. Some have placed their dads into your presence. But we're grateful. Their influence is always with us. We ask your help and blessing upon us, particularly the men who are dads, whether dads in a literal sense or dads to people as teachers or community leaders or scout leaders or in whatever capacity, to lead rightly, to be good examples. We're grateful for how you've answered prayer in so many, many ways, and grateful for the ministry of prayer here at this church and the members of the prayer team whose prayers are fervent and faithful. We're grateful for those we've made mention of in our prayers because we know you hear their cries too. We think of our nation and the convulsions going on, pain, tension, violence, division. Only you can heal. But we ask that you would use us as a part of that, that you use us not to be people who further divide, but bring together, to be people who believe in the reconciliation that Jesus accomplishes, that when he stretched his arms out on the cross, he embraced the whole world. Help us to embrace those around us in your name. We ask you guide our nation through this time and the nations of the world. We pray for those working on cures for this virus, for the vaccines that are being researched and will one day be prepared. We pray that as we go through this time, as it is a time of testing, that you would bring us through and we would come out faithful to you and our lives shining with your grace, growing in faith and hope and love. Remember, too, the men and women of our military who serve in places of danger and harm. And we think, too, of first responders in their many capacities and pray your grace and blessing upon them. We know you hear us in the prayers of our hearts, which in the silence of this moment we lift before you. Hear our prayer as we pray it in the name of Jesus, who teaches us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for your faithful support of our church. It tells me that you believe in my future and the future of the Greencastle Presbyterian Church. I'm grateful for that and your faithful support. May God richly bless all of us together. All of us together, we believe in a future for our church and for the witness of Christ in our community.
Because of our church cares about our future, I want to thank you for tuning in today to our worship service. Thank you for the faithfulness in this time of the COVID-19 virus. And thank you for believing that God has a future, and I hope for all of us.
As you go forward into your day and into the week, I want you to know a few things about Hagar. Hagar was the first person in the Bible to weep, and God, who hears, heard her cry. That she is the outsider, the Egyptian, a woman of color, who discovered that God was there and gave him a name, which is the God who sees. May the God who sees and hears all that's around us bless us through it all and use us to bring healing and grace. Go for this week in the confidence that Christ is with you. And may the love of God and the fellowship of Jesus and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.